Good evening. And thank you for coming to the sixth presentation of the lecture season, which is generally supported year after year by the Lowell Institute here in Boston, allowing these talks to be free and open to the public. And it is my great pleasure as the chief executive officer of the New England Aquarium to welcome you here tonight. And I'm very excited to be hearing our honored guests, Dr. Gillian Braulik and Dr. Rohan Arthur, who will share their ocean conservation stories with you. Stories that span from the Indus River in Pakistan to the remote Lakshadweep archipelago in the Indian Ocean. Now, I practiced saying that earlier, but I still haven't quite got it right. But luckily, Rohan has forgiven me, at least I think so. The aquarium is very proud to have supported the groundbreaking work both of Jill and Rohan through our Marine Conservation Action Fund, or MCAF, a unique granting program that has supported 118 projects in 37 countries across six continents since 1999. And MCAF exists because of the aquarium's strong commitment to ocean conservation, and it's one of a number of long-standing conservation and research programs here at the aquarium, including our Sustainable Seafood Initiative, the Phoenix Islands Protected Area, and our North Atlantic Right Whale program, just to name a few. As you probably know, I've only been here about 5 months, and I have been really excited to discover MCAF. I feel that through MCAF, the aquarium provides technical and financial support to ocean conservation leaders around the world who, like Rohan and Jill, share the aquarium's dedication to protecting the ocean. In this way, MCAF is a catalyst for change, enabling stories of hope for the oceans. And I want to give you just a few examples of how MCAF support, what it's helped to enable. The protection of tens of thousands of sea turtle hatchlings from poachers and predators in countries such as Costa Rica, India, Indonesia, and Mexico. And the education of hundreds of Kenyan students in local marine resource conservation. The photo identification of over 400 whale sharks being monitored after the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. The collection of data that helps strengthen protections for manta rays and scalloped hammerhead sharks under the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, CITES, and the establishment of the first marine mammal stranding network in Iran. Having the MCAF program at the aquarium provides us the unique opportunity to share these stories of hope and spread the word about the important work our grantees are doing. And we do this through exhibits, social media, and our newsletter, and through public lectures such as this event tonight. And by showing how they have tackled the most challenging problems facing the ocean, these conservation leaders will help to inspire the next generation of ocean stewards. All of this would not be possible without the generous support of our funders, which includes the Oak Foundation, the Curtis and Edith Munchen Foundation, a number of individual donors, and the New England Aquarium. MCAF also benefits from a terrific advisory committee, which is an international team of aquarium scientists and outside experts who donate their time to review the proposals that we receive. And they often provide a lot of guidance to our grantees. And we're very fortunate to have some of the committee members with us here tonight. And we have Alan Diner, Helen Tausig, and I don't know if John Mandelman is here, but he's another member of staff who is on the committee. And it's because of the committee that we're able to identify and support the projects with the most promise to have significant conservation impact. And projects such as the ones that we're about to hear from Jill and Rohan. And I would like to start now by introducing you to Dr. Rohan Arthur. Rohan Arthur is a senior scientist at the Nature Conservation Foundation in Karnataka, India, head of its Oceans and Coast Division, and one of the founding trustees of the organization. His current work explores how humans interact with and use marine ecosystems, and it's focused on the Andaman and the Nicobar Islands in the Bay of Bengal, and, here we go again, the Lakshadweep Archipelago, a group of low-lying coral atolls situated north of the Maldives in the northern Indian Ocean. Arthur is working to understand the responses of these reef systems to climate shifts and the ability of species to adapt to climate and to ocean changes. In 2013, Rohan was awarded a prestigious Pew Fellowship to further his reef resilience work. Please join me in welcoming Rohan.
Thank you all for coming, and thanks for the introduction. First of all, I'd really like to thank MCAF for their incredible support and in inviting me here and getting us across all the way from San Francisco to here. I'm just visiting for the Pew meeting, both Jill and I, and it was really nice to be able to come down here and talk to you people. The support that MCAF gave us came at a very critical time, and it was a small amount of money, but it went a real long distance, and that the kind of support that MCAF gave us has been valuable in continuing our research ever since. So this is where we work. We work in the Lakshadweep Islands, this is India, as many of you know, and the Lakshadweep Islands are just that those few bumps at the top of the volcanic ridge, that is the Lakshadweep Takeoff Ridge. And most of you are most probably familiar with the Maldives. The Lakshadweep are a group of very, very tiny islands, only 32 square kilometers north of that, off the Maldives. Okay? And it has a large human population. And my talk is titled Cloud Compasses. And so when I first started working in the Lakshadweep archipelago, sometime in around 1996, I would travel between these atolls on a small wooden boat. The boat's called the Kukubi. You can see it. It's the oldest picture I have of the Kukubi. And we would travel to these different islands to sample them. And at the helm of that boat was this old sailor, this person called Captain Koya. And we had a compass on board, of course, it was part of the necessary safety equipment. But the captain never once deigned to look at the compass. It was almost like it was beneath him to look at the compass. So I asked him about this. I said, how does he navigate? And he said, he knows how to use the compass, but he preferred to navigate using the clouds. And I was incredulous, of course. I think that there's a Captain Koya in pretty much every port in India. You go to the port in India, you'll see an old wise man sitting in the corner who will tell you tall tales. So I thought Captain Koya was just one of these characters. But he was very, very insistent. Okay? He insisted, he said that the atolls attracted clouds. Okay. And if you looked over the horizon, at the clouds, you could see the reflection of the lagoon on the underside of the clouds. And all you needed to do is to steer your boat towards reflected green, and you would reach your island. So these are the kind of islands I work on. Yes, I know, it's really difficult to convince people I'm working there. But I've been honest, and I've seen the lagoons reflected in the clouds. You can actually see this. Before you see the island on the horizon, you see a bunch of clouds, and there'll be some clouds which have green reflected at the bottom, and it makes a very good compass. Okay. But whether I would trust myself to navigate with these cloud compasses is another matter. Today, with GPSs on every device, we may never need these nebulous navigational aids. Yet, for me, there is something profound and valuable in the idea of navigating by reflection. Using incidental compasses, nebulous as they may be, to find our way. So, in this talk, what I will attempt to do is to weave a few stories from our work in the Indian Ocean, which to me talk about the possibility of navigating to conservation outcomes using incidental compasses. So why do we need them? What is this all about? Is this just a straw man? But for a start, we know that the oceans and their ecosystems are under enormous threat from a range of global and regional pressures. If you've been attending these talks often enough, you'll probably have heard the familiar litany that we environmental types are constantly throwing at you. Overfishing, pollution, coastal development, increasing ocean temperatures, sea level rise, ocean acidification, you name it, you know the list. It's a long, long list. In the face of all of this, the best weapon that we have been able to develop to conserve the reefs and to conserve marine areas is the marine protected area. Right? This is an area which we fence off and prevent all forms of extraction with the hope that they serve as an insurance program against the worst threat a species can do to the seas. And what do you know? The MPA works. The marine protected area works really well. Okay? We know this from enough studies not to question that this is the best management tool that we have in our toolbox. MPAs work. Right? The US government recently signed into law the biggest marine reserve in the world, in the Pacific. And in many ways, your country is leading the way in making marine conservation a global reality. Yet we cannot escape the fact that the conditions under which we can establish MPAs is vanishingly small. This is particularly true in the developing tropics, from where I come from, where the dependence of local fishing communities on nearshore coastal waters is very high. These are often the poorest people on the planet. And with very little access to anything else, the small fishing communities that depend on the reef and depend on marine areas for their basic livelihood. They are least able to afford giving up on rich fishing grounds, yet they are the ones that have been often asked, to pay the price for the conservation that we would like to see. Right? And without that cooperation, most MPAs will just not be successful. We need them to cooperate. We need them on our side if MPAs have to be useful. The Pacific Reserve, as large as it is, has no permanent living populations anywhere in it. So that's easy in comparison. I suspect if you're lucky, we may be able to protect 1-2% of the ocean surface. When what we really need is protecting about 10, if not more, percent of the ocean surface. What I'm trying to argue is not that we don't need MPAs. What I'm going to argue is that what do we do in the remaining 98% where the conditions for establishing MPAs just don't exist? And to that, I think we need a much larger set of tools. And we need to explore them, no matter how far-fetched they might be. And if cloud compasses work, then why not? Okay. So with that rather long preamble, let me get to my amazing narratives. I'm going to give you just about two narratives. My first story will stay in the Lakshadweep Islands. When I was a young researcher, the place was paradise. It was spectacular. The reefs were unexplored. Every dive that I was doing was a discovery. Okay. I've always felt that the reefs were a playfully irresponsible place and an unashamed celebration of kitsch and extravagance. And the luxury reefs were no exception at all. And then the El Nino of 1998 happened. And I'm sure you've heard the story so many times from so many places, but what I was seeing in the luxury reef was absolutely devastating. In front of my eyes, the corals were turning completely white, they were bleaching. And I helplessly watched as sea surface temperatures rose and the corals died. This was sometime in early May, and I couldn't sample the reefs anymore because the monsoons had come to the Lakshadweep and you can't dive in the monsoons. The earliest I could get back was December, and that's what I saw in December. Almost uniformly across the Lakshadweep, between 80-90% of the reefs had died. And what was left was a completely barren deadscape, from which it was absolutely impossible to imagine recovery. And from reefs across the tropics, we were hearing similarly depressing stories emerging. Subject to coral mass mortalities, tropical reefs were declining. With the coral gone, macroalgae were taking over, and the reefs stayed in the state unable to recover. So this was not a very optimistic scenario, and I was just about starting my PhD. Okay? And so this is when I went in. I went back to the Lakshadweep each year, fully expecting to be documenting another path to extinction for these reefs in the Lakshadweep. What emerged was something quite different. Instead of the predictable decline, the reefs of the Lakshadweep were behaving in a much messier fashion. Okay. There were recruits happening everywhere, okay. And some of these reefs, okay, some of them were definitely declining, okay, but in some reefs, they seemed to be dancing to their own tune. And in some reason, 7 or 8 years, I saw a remarkable recovery. This is not the picture everywhere, okay? But in many reefs, this was what was happening in 7 or 8 years. Okay. If I was expecting clarity from my reefs, what I got instead was a very confusing picture of reef responses. This is not the way reefs are supposed to be behaving. Okay. So we've been With my team, we've been tracking these patterns for the last 17 years or so. And that gray red part in the middle is these what I call funding-shaped holes in the data. Okay. When I just ran out of funding, I saw all these interesting patterns emerging, couldn't make sense of it, ran out of funding. Around 2010, I managed to get back and do a little bit of work after in 2007. 2010, MCAF came in and gave me enough money to buy a little compressor, which I could take around with me. And that has been enough to sustain me to go back into these locations. Often, small amounts of money like that can sustain you and take you much, much further, and allow you to see see patterns that you wouldn't have seen if you just had 3 or 4 years to do the work. And only now, after about 17 or 18 years, are we dimly beginning to understand the complex, unruly responses that the lush reef are showing us. What you can see is that some reefs go through these major shifts. They decline, but they recover really well. Others remain relatively stable, and others decline and don't recover at all. So everything seems to be occurring in the lush reef after these major disturbances. What, in several factors, seem to be important. One of them is structural stability and hydrodynamics. Okay. Coral recruitment is very, very important, of course. Okay. But what appears to be critical across the lush reef is that herbivore fish numbers are incredibly high, okay, particularly after a mass breeding event. So essentially what happens is that you have a huge number of herbivores, they completely scrape all the surfaces clean, they allow new recruitment to come in, and in places where new recruitment comes in and they have high herbivore densities, corals can recover dramatically. To give you a sense, after 1998, herbivores constituted something like 80% of all the fish on the reef in terms of biomass. So why is this surprising? Okay. Why should I be surprised by this? Well, the lush reef is not an isolated, unpeopled archipelago protected within the bounds of this marine protected area. There are no marine protected areas in the lush reef. And inside marine protected areas, we have seen this kind of recovery, this kind of protection, this kind of ability to recover. We have been able to see that. Okay. This is an island which has more than 2,000 people per square kilometer, making it one of the densest parts of rural India. Okay. This is not one of those unpeopled Pacific islands. And the entire population depends heavily on fish as their principal protein. So what's happening? That's how fishing, that's the red line that shows you what the fish landings in the lush reef. And as populations have grown, fish landings have grown. People have required more fish. Okay. But what this graph hides is that there's a dramatic shift that took place sometime in the 1970s. Before this, before the 1970s, almost much of the fishing was taking place for reef fish. Okay. But in the 1970s, the fisheries department introduced a pole and line fishery for the oceanic skipjack tuna to the lush reef. And it trained fishermen in the technique, subsidizing boats, giving them gear, subsidizing the fuel, the lot. Okay. The program was so successful that it took off and soon became the dominant fishery in the island. So what the fishermen do is they use live bait that they catch from the surrounding waters, and they follow around shoals of tuna, which they catch using poles and line. Okay, the tuna is then processed and sun-dried before it is sold. The technique places natural limits on how much fish you can be caught in a single fishing trip. There is no bycatch. You're not catching turtles, you're not catching dolphins. And it's a great money earner. So that's what we see. We see that after the 1970s, most of that fishing is actually not for the reef. It's all for pelagic tuna. Okay? So importantly to our story, the tuna fishery has completely replaced reef fishing as the primary source of protein, and it is the dominant money earner for the islands. For me, this difference between reef fishing and tuna fishing represents a very significant subsidy on the reef that would have been subject to much, much higher rates of fishing if it was not for the tuna. And then we would have probably seen a very, very different story, a story that I was expecting as a young PhD going into the lush reef. So what is important to take away from the story is that the tuna fishing program was not designed with the conservation of the coral reef in mind. Okay. It was established to encourage a previously unexplored fishery. As one fisheries officer put it, the tuna in the Indian Ocean are dying of old age, and that's unacceptable. We have to put a stop to that. And it has been great for the reef. because it has conferred it with the resilience that other fish reefs just do not have. Okay. Now, there's another El Nino coming up, and I'm going back to the field as soon as I finish with the U.S., and I hope that El Nino doesn't happen, because I really don't know whether the reefs can actually take the sustained bleaching every few years. But what I do know is that the reefs of the Lakshadweep have the best chance they've got. Okay. But we have got here navigating by a cloud compass, okay, using the reflected light of an economic venture to build an accidental resilience for these fragile reefs. So that's my first little story. The second one, we move across to the east to a very different set of islands. That's a group of islands very close to Indonesia called the Andaman and Nicobars, and we'll be focusing on the Nicobars. They are, unlike Lakshadweep, they're not atolls. They are relatively young outcrops of the Himalayan range. Okay. And they, this is where the Indian plate is pushing against the Asian plate, and what the rocky outcrops come up as the Lakshadweep and as the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So these islands are thickly covered with tropical rainforests, and mangroves. Over here, the human communities, are as interesting as the reefs themselves, the reefs and people themselves. They are of an Indo-Malayan origin, and they are a fascinating admixture of culture and contradictions. Nominally, they are Christian, having been converted to the faith by early missionaries. They go to church every Sunday, they religiously celebrate all the major Christian festivals. Yet, through it all, they retain much of their animistic and totemistic traditions. So this is one of the last shamans that remains in the Nicobar Islands. Okay, and he's wearing a garland of banana leaves. And they smear their body with pig blood, okay, during all the festivals, even during Easter. Okay, and Christian ritual and shaman sacrifice sit very, very comfortably with each other in the lives of the Nicobarites. For me, this picture represents everything. You have a young boy, okay, smeared in pig blood with a mobile phone in his hand. So, you have shamanistic tradition, modern culture, all mixed up together in these islands. The Nicobarites depend very heavily on the reef for their food, and they cultivate coconuts, betel nut, banana, a variety of other crops on the land. There are, once again, like the Lakshadweep, there are no marine protected areas anywhere. Okay. They also depend a lot on pigs. Okay. And because they are a very special group of islands and very special group of islanders, they are exempt from the restrictions imposed by the Indian Wildlife Protection Act. Being a scheduled tribe, they can, for instance, if they choose, hunt even endangered species like the dugong for traditional use. If they wanted to, they could hunt the dugong. So yet, even without government restrictions, the waters of the Nicobar are actually a complex map of restrictions and regulations, which one of my doctoral students, Vardhan Patankar, he's not lying at the back of a boat, he's been trying to unpack. And what he's been finding is that the Nicobar reefs are managed with a series of traditional rules that prohibit the hunting of several species, okay, including they ban a lot of species, certain times of the year are banned. There are bans on certain type of gear. Okay, this is a particular kind of gear which can only be used at particular times, okay, for a particular kind of species. Okay. There are seasonal, there are temporal restrictions, and several other systems that serve to regulate reef harvests. So for instance, there are some reefs that are not fished for an entire year, and then open to fish for a single day. You can go out and fish just one day in the year on those reefs. At other areas, for some reason, you're allowed to fish for 2 days, okay, or for 4 days, but not for 3 days, okay, for whatever reason. Right? The cost of disobeying these complex rules is high, and any errant fisherman can be fined anything from a chicken to a pig, and a pig is one of the most prized possessions of the Nicobarites. But if you violate these rules that are established by the community, okay, you can be asked to cut a pig, or be given several days of hard labor working for the community. Okay, so they're very strictly enforced. What Vardhan's research is showing is that where these regulations are strictly enforced, they work as well as an MPA would. Okay, without there being a single MPA, these restrictions work as well. And with abundances of fish, much higher inside them than in the adjacent areas. Now, that is not particularly surprising. You would expect that. What is truly interesting is how these regulations are perceived and enforced by members of the community. In our interviews, none of the fishers ever connected these restrictions with any form of regulatory fisheries management. They didn't think that what they were doing was regulatory fisheries management. Okay. Instead, fishers link these restrictions with this firm set of beliefs that is built into the tapestry of the common life of the Nicobars. As you can see, and it's represented very heavily in their symbology, the wrath of the native spirits can be merciless. Fishing in a restricted area is sure to bring on bad weather, as happened during the tsunami of 2004. Okay. Worse still, the coconut crops and vegetable plantations would be destroyed by flood or disease. If the spirits so dictated, the entire community could be broken apart by a single act of disobedience. Many of these were actually processes that the Nicobarese experienced during the years after the tsunami. And many people actually linked that to this disobedience. So while some of the forces that exercised their strict control over these reefs were supernatural, very often they are very real in the minds of the islanders. Many of the Nicobarese, many of the Nicobarese reefs are guarded by a giant octopus, apparently. That overturns the boat of any errant fisherman that wanders into these waters during unauthorized times. And the fishermen truly believe this. So another of my students, Manish Chandi, has been living along the Nicobarese since 1996. He spends months at a time on the island and has been trying to understand exactly how they share and manage their natural resources. Doing justice to Manish's work, it will probably require another few hours of its own, but for today, a single story will suffice. Many of the Nicobar communities maintain separate uninhabited islands as resource islands. These are places where people don't live. They only go there to take natural resources. They hunt fish, they hunt pig, they hunt crocodile. They used to get logs of wood for boat for construction. The islands themselves are highly restricted and very, very few people have access to them. To get on the island, you need to know a secret language. With a vocabulary that is very, very complex of its own. And it can only be spoken on the island. When you're on the island, you can speak nothing else but this language. Accessing the island requires you to go through a complex initiation rite, which, by the way, Manish has gone through himself. Once you're on the island, you can only hunt with traditional weapons, and any animal caught has to be cooked, killed, and eaten with a boggling set of rules. What Manish is documenting is there exists in the Nicobar not one, but at least four separate secret languages, each associated with different islands or the harvesting of particular resources. So this, for instance, is clay, which is used to convert into those ceremonial pots, which are very, very important for the ceremonies in the Nicobars. And once again, to access this mud, you have a small secret language that has evolved only for the access of clay for this for pots. So documenting these languages is not easy, but from what Manish has been able to piece together, the vocabulary of these languages is largely a set of place names and resources, the cardinal directions, for instance, north, south, east, west. Where to find fresh water, where the wild pigs are. So the language is rich with information, and it appears to encode a map of the resources. So it is easy to see how for these resources, language itself becomes a powerful agent of control. Together with the associated harvest rules, they restrict access to a limited few. So if you know the language or you don't. And to the initiated, if you actually know the language, they provide information on how best to harvest these resources. So it works really, really well as a management tool. Both on land and sea, then, the Nicobar communities are managing their natural resources. Yet, like the Lakshadweep, they're navigating to management goals with cloud compasses, using complex mythology, superstition, and even language as means to conserve their resources. From what we are seeing on these islands, where these beliefs and practices continue, they can be very effective, even if resource conservation was not their explicit purpose. So where am I going with all of this? I've spun you a bunch of tall tales with, full of slightly difficult to believe narratives. Yet what I'm arguing is that these narratives, like all stories, have agency. Stories, when they are well told, are powerful things. We can all choose the stories we want to tell of the system. As an ecologist with an agenda to conserve the reef, my stories are naturally ecological. They are based on describing how ecosystems behave under different circumstances and the mechanisms that drive these behaviors. These, for me, connect me to the reef. Right? They help me understand the reefs of the Luxor Reef every time I dive there. Yet I recognize full well that the identity of a local fisher maybe arises from a very, very different set of imperatives and understandings. Right? For him, putting food on the table is probably much, much more important. Being a good husband or a good father, a man of faith, keeping the village elders happy, making sure that the wrath of a giant octopus is not stirred up. Those are the things that connect him to the natural resources around him. We are all linked, I think, all of us, to these mythologies, no matter how fabulous or how mundane they may be. These stories connect us deeply to a sense of identity, of community, of history, and of geography, a sense of place. There is, I think, a deep human need to maintain these connections. And that connection may often transcend the economic rationality or ecological reality. I think that if we manage to tap into these connections, we can often find common goals, even if these goals are nothing more than serendipitous accidents. Okay. The resilience of the Luxor Reef Reef is dependent on the flourishing fishery of a pelagic tuna. Okay. The reefs of the Nicobar are managed by a giant octopus, while the extraction of resources from land are governed by secret languages. It doesn't really matter. Okay. There are many paths to reach the Isle of Serendip, and often the most direct path may not often get you there. MPAs are always going to be the most effective way to conserve marine areas, if you can get them to happen. And you have the science to know where to create them. And you can convince local people of their value. And you have the manpower and resources to police them. I'm arguing about what you have to do when you don't have all these ducks in a row. Right? For these remaining places, this wider toolbox of incidental conservation, finding out what links to the deepest identity of local communities, and using that to ensure resources are sustainably managed. There may be our best bet. In the case of the Luxor Reef, conserving the reef may actually mean finding ways to support the tuna fishery and make it more economically sustainable. In the Nicobars, it may mean reinforcing the sense of identity local communities have with their traditional systems of belief and strengthening the institutions that maintain these beliefs. So giant octopuses don't exist everywhere, I'll admit. And cloud compasses may not always take us to our destination. But keeping our eyes open for them, at the very least, gives us a larger set of tools when trying to conserve these vanishing ecosystems. That's all. Thank you.
Rohan, thank you so much for a fascinating talk, and there will be time after the next presentation for questions to both speakers. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Gill Braulik. Perfect. Dr. Gillian Braulik is a researcher based in Tanzania and affiliated with the Wildlife Conservation Society and the University of St. Andrews in the UK. Her work has illuminated the threats that the Indus River dolphin faces and what is needed to improve its conservation status. In addition to her work in Pakistan, Braulik has been involved with river dolphins on the Brahmaputra River in India and in the Sundarbans mangrove forest of Bangladesh. She was also committed to the final efforts to save the Yangtze River dolphin in China. Her long-term interest in training and facilitating biologists in Iran has led her to establish marine mammal research and conservation programs in the Persian Gulf and the Arabian Sea. Jill was awarded a Pew Fellowship in 2013 to study marine mammals in Tanzania. Early in her career, Jill also served on the New England Aquarium's right whale survey team. So in a way, you could say she's come home. Please join me in introducing Gill Braulik.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. So now I'm going to take you from the tropical waters of the Indian Ocean to the rivers of Pakistan. I'm going to talk about the Indus River dolphin, which is one of the most endangered mammals in the world, and one that I have been working and trying to conserve for around the last 15 years. So Indus dolphins occur only in Pakistan. They live in fresh water, and they never go. They never enter the sea. They can't tolerate salt water. And they occur over several thousand kilometers of river. So just to orientate you, Pakistan is the country at the end of the red arrow there, and it's bordered to the east by India, to the west by Iran, and the north is China, and the south is the Indian Ocean. And I know there's been a lot of negative press about Pakistan in the news, but I spent a great deal of time in Pakistan and had an incredible experience. I've always been welcomed. It has an incredibly rich culture, and some of the most welcoming people of anywhere I've ever traveled. So it's been an overwhelmingly positive experience and a great place to work. So this is a map of the topography of the Indian subcontinent. The Indus River is the river on your left, and the Ganges River system, Ganges and Brahmaputra, is the one on the right. And they are both mighty river systems that drain the Himalayas, the highest mountains in the world. And they've been in their current configuration for around 40 million years. So they're also ancient, ancient rivers. And there are freshwater dolphins that live in both of these river systems. They've believed to have been there for around 20 million years. They are closely related to each other, but they evolved long before most other cetaceans. They're more closely related to sperm whales than they are to any other dolphin. These are adult Indus dolphins, and you see they're brown in color. They have very long rostrum with long, thin, interlocking teeth that protrude. And a very tiny eye, just a pinhole for the eye. And they believe that the eye can only detect light and dark. There's no functioning lens. And the reason for this is that they live in very turbid water. You can see in this picture that the river is naturally, it's basically like milk tea. And so over millions of years, dolphins have evolved echolocation to find out about their environment. And the need for eyes has decreased, so the eye has degenerated over time. But in Pakistan, these animals are known as the blind dolphins. So Indus dolphins are unusual in that we have very detailed information about their historical distribution. This is from an incredibly simple but really, really powerfully useful piece of research that was conducted in the 1800s by a British civil servant called John Anderson. He was a zoologist who lived in Calcutta. He ran the Indian Museum. And from his office window, he could see dolphins in the rivers at Calcutta. And he started an incredibly detailed research project and produced a huge, thick manuscript. And he gathered information by writing letters to people all over the Indian subcontinent. He wrote letters to all of the government outposts, the garrisons, and the civil servants' offices in Burma, Bangladesh, India, and Pakistan. So in his book, he says, notwithstanding that the inquiry was of a novel and rather unusual character, the replies were most complete and full of interest. And moreover, examples of the dolphin were sent to me from the Indus, the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra. So he was flooded with information, and possibly even samples of the dolphins were sent to him. So based on this, he produced a map of where the dolphins occurred 150 years ago. And this is quite unusual for any species to have such detailed information about the historical distribution. Normally, we're trying to piece it together from all the sources that we can find. But we're in a fortunate position in this case. So we know that 150 years ago, dolphins were found all the way from the Delta up to basically where the red line is, so the base of the Himalayas, a distance of around 3,500 kilometers of free-flowing river, including all the major tributaries of the Indus, so the Jhelum, Chenab, Ravi, Sutlej, and the BS rivers, as well as the Indus itself. So this brings us to the present day and a very different situation. Pakistan is one of the most arid and water-stressed countries in Asia. And over the last 100 years, an enormous irrigation network has been constructed on the Indus River. There have been at least 20 irrigation barrages or high dams that have represented on this map by the black squares. That have fragmented the river into 17 different sections. So the places where dolphins occurred before are now 17 pockets between these dams. So this free-flowing river is now transformed into a carefully managed irrigation network. And there are thousands of miles of canal, numerous high dams, multiple irrigation barrages or diversion dams. And for many months of the year, numerous parts of the river are now dry, and the water only flows through the delta to the sea for about 6 months. So downstream, the river runs dry. So this is an aerial photograph of Sukkur Barrage, which is one of the biggest. And you can see the water flows flowing from right to left, and there are seven canals that lead off of this lead off of the river, and the barrages basically, their function is to divert water, so they don't store, they don't really store water like high dams, but they divert it into these canals. And the big message really from this picture is how much water is diverted, because downstream there's hardly any water left in the river. And all of the white on this image is sand. So when I first went to Pakistan in 1999, and at that time, there was very little information about this animal. We knew it was endangered. Nobody really knew whether there were any left, where they were still found. There were no ongoing conservation efforts. So my work from the beginning was to really address the fundamental questions for conservation. Where are they? How many are there? Is the population going up or down? What are the reasons for the decline? So. Really key questions for conserving this species. And it is an incredible place. This river is unbelievably beautiful. Even though Pakistan has an incredibly dense population, the river is really very quiet. There's hardly any people. It's not used for transport. It's not very intensively fished. It's a huge 2-3 kilometers wide river that runs through white sand. It's shallow, it's braided. There's huge freshwater turtles, there's river terns, and there's these incredible ancient blind river dolphins. So it's a fantastic place to be. And so to try and capture that, I want to show you this short video clip that actually kind of, for me at least, captures some of the essence of the river more than still photos can ever do.
The mighty Indus River is almost as old as the subcontinent itself and home to a great diversity of wildlife that has coexisted with human civilization for the last 5,000 years. For most of this period, humans and animals have lived in relative harmony, but in the last 200 years, conflict has arisen as the most extensive irrigation system in the world has been laid down to harness the great river. The blind Indus River dolphin is one victim of this conflict. Almost impenetrable barrages have carved up to its home range so that it has virtually no room to move along the river that was once its home territory. The waters of the Indus are polluted by human activity as it runs its tremendous course to the ocean. The dolphin has to compete with man for the fish that forms an essential part of its diet. Occasionally, the river dolphin is trapped in fishing nets, which can mean death for the mammal. And as is the case in many developing countries, there are limited financial resources to conserve this rare animal. The Indus River dolphin is the most unique of the very unusual kind of cetacean. Centuries of living in turbid waters of the Indus have meant that eyes were not needed. The dolphin has developed a sophisticated sonar system that it uses to steer by and hunt under the water. Its habitat is now confined to the area between two barrages, Sakhar and Tonsa, on the Indus. This rare and endemic species represents a unique genome, an irreplaceable part of the biodiversity of life on Earth. The closest known interaction of the river dolphin with humans is with the Mohanas, the boat people of the Indus, who are fishermen and who have lived on the river for centuries. Their houseboats drift silently up and down the river all year, and they rely on fishing contracts issued by the government. The river dolphin has featured in the folklore of the boat people, mostly as a benign and harmless creature.
All right. There we go. So I hope that gives you sort of more of a feeling for the kind of habitat that we're talking about. So I want to tell you some stories now about some of the early expeditions. I've been involved for many years now, but I want to talk about the very first expedition that we ever ran. So in 2001, early on in my stay in Pakistan, we launched an expedition to try and find out where the dolphins remained. So we sailed for 1,600 kilometers down the Indus River from basically from top to bottom of this map. We had 35 people, it took 7 weeks, and we rowed because we couldn't find, there were not, boats with motors were not freely available. So it was a major undertaking. It may sound like a fairly simple thing to do, but in fact it was one of the hardest things I've ever done. And we had numerous events along the way that made it particularly interesting. These are the boats that we used. We used locally available fishing boats. Without motors, we built viewing platforms so that we could have observers high up with a good view over the river. We camped, we took everything with us, so we had our own tents, we had cooks, support team. We had to carry all water and food because there's no road access to the river other than each of these dams. So we camped on the banks of the river at night, and we packed up and moved each day and set up a new camp the following day. And it's really incredible to camp on the banks of the river because at night you can hear the dolphins surfacing, so it's really silent at night. And when they come to the surface to breathe, you can kind of hear it when you're sleeping in your tent. So we set up a team of Pakistani Wildlife Department government researchers and students from the university. We ran training courses in dolphin survey methods, and this had never been attempted in Pakistan before. And at that time, this was by far the largest wildlife expedition that had ever been run. Nobody had ever done anything logistically as challenging as this. We ran training courses, and then, let me skip back. we departed in the peak of the dry season, because when the river is smaller, not swollen by the floods, the dolphins are concentrated into a much smaller area and are easier to count. During the summer, the river becomes huge and the dolphins disperse. So, every time we reached each barrage, we would stop, refuel, get more food, get more water, visit the local universities and give talks, and then carry on downstream. But also these irrigation barrages were a complete barrier to, we couldn't sail through them because the gates were closed. And so there was no way around them. So we had to remove the boats from the river to get them around the barrage. So the first time we encountered one of these, I talked to the boatman and they said, oh, it's no problem. We do this all the time. Don't worry. So I went to give a talk at a university and I came back to the river at lunchtime expecting all the boats to be downstream and everybody ready to go. And I was confronted by this scene. The poor camel is attached to a cart with the boat on it, and the entire thing is buried in the mud. The poor camel's buried in the mud up to his shoulders, and he'd been there for several hours trying to pull the boat out of the river. And he was bellowing and growling, So in the end, we had to go and find a tractor to pull the camel and the cart and the boat out of the river. And then we transported our boats on camel carts around the barrage and then put them back on the river downstream. So every time we reached one of these barrages, there was some new technique for how we were going to move the boats. Camel carts was one of the more successful options. On another occasion, we came across this bridge that was not on any of the maps. It's a seasonal bridge that's floating on pontoons. And there was a constant stream of huge trucks loaded with sugarcane crossing this floating bridge. And the gap between the bottom of the bridge and the water surface was very small, much too small for us to actually sail underneath. And we couldn't get the boats out of the river either. So we had to take the whole platform down, and then the manager of the boat jacked up some of the bridge using a truck jack, and we sank the boat by putting as many people inside as we could to squash underneath the bridge. Meanwhile, the trucks were still driving overhead. So the river is really it's a very peaceful, quiet place. But as we continued to travel downstream, more and more local people had heard about this expedition that was this flotilla of boats and people traveling along the river. And more people came down to the river to see what was going on, to ask us questions. And so we had this great reception as we went along the river. And there's one particular lady that I remember who came down and asked to talk to me specifically. She was wearing this beautiful red and gold shalwar kameez, and she brought these three girls in the bottom picture, and she said she just wanted to see if it was really true that there was a woman leading all these men down the river. And she wanted her daughters to shake my hand. So we've been sailing for about a month, and we entered an area in Sindh province, which is towards the south of the river, which is a tribal area of Pakistan. And you've probably heard about the tribal areas of Pakistan near Afghanistan, which are in the news quite a lot. So this is somewhat similar in that tribal landlords have jurisdiction over their own piece of property and the government have very limited control. And so because of that, the authorities were very nervous about us sailing into this area because it's quite unsafe, not many people move there. So their response was to send lots and lots of policemen with us. At its peak, I think we had about 200 Pakistani policemen escorting our three boats and 30 people. And you can see in the top picture, we had streams of policemen marching along the riverbanks ahead of us while we sailed downstream trying to count dolphins. They commandeered the boats from local fishermen to sail alongside us. Despite all of these efforts, on the second day, we did actually get shot at. There were gunmen running along the riverbank and lying down and taking aim and shooting at us, and we could hear the bullets coming past and yelling at us to stop. So we immediately stopped and hid behind the boats. And we got on the radio and radioed the police superintendent. And it just so happened that he was already on the other bank having tea with the tribal leader. And so he came to the bank. He was there in like 2 minutes. And they waved us over, so we got back in the boats and went over to the bank. And we all sat down and had tea with the people who'd been shooting at us. And it was fine. And then we carried on downstream. So after this, we were a little bit wiser, and we negotiated with each tribal leader before entering their territory and explained what we were doing and asked for their permission to pass through their land. And they sent representatives of their tribe on our boat to ensure our safety. So we had all of these different colorful characters on board that we picked up at the edge of their territory and then dropped in another place. One particular tribal leader, Essun Sundrani, had bright red hair, and he was an incredibly powerful man. And he had a man with him whose job it was to hold his telephone to his ear. And another man who was responsible for holding his Kalashnikovs. So, at the end of this expedition, although we had all of these trials and tribulations, by far we were incredibly successful. We collected fabulous data. We covered the entire range of the dolphin. Nobody had done this before. We found dolphins in places nobody expected. We recorded more dolphins than anybody expected. So it was overwhelmingly successful. But the area of concentration now is the area between these two yellow arrows. So if you compare this to Anderson's map, it's a big change. We recorded around 1,200 animals. 1,200 dolphins left for this entire subspecies, split into six different subpopulations. Many of which, at least three of which, only had 10 or 20 animals. The one at the very top, we only recorded two, very lonely up there. But elsewhere, particularly in the dangerous area where we had all the police, was where the most dolphins were. And actually, it was quite surprising that the density in that one particular area was incredibly high. So although the numbers overall, it's not hugely encouraging, in this one particular place there are dolphins everywhere. Densities higher than almost any other dolphin in the world. So there's this huge concentration in one spot. And it happens to be a place where the threats are fairly minimal. And it's also a protected area, specifically for the dolphin. So there is some bright spark in there. So moving on from this, we moved on to other questions to ask why the dolphins have disappeared from so many places. What are the reasons? And what, once we have that information, what can we do? What can we do to make the situation better? So to try and understand more about why the animals have disappeared and where, we went to the places where we suspected they had already gone. And we traveled around and talked to the oldest fishermen that we could find in all of these fishing villages on the rivers to try and ask them what they remembered about the past, when they used to see dolphins in the river, what their stories were, and so that we could build up a picture of when the animals disappeared from each part of the river. And we met some fascinating characters. It was very interesting to enter each village and ask to speak to the oldest fishermen. And so we talked to some. Some of them were longing to tell their stories, others were just really grumpy and not very interested in talking to us. Some were really had very grandfatherly, so it was a fascinating experience. And what we did was build up this picture of how the decline happened. So based on this map, the blue areas are where the dolphins still exist, and the red areas are those that disappeared in the 1980s, so most recently. And then the orange areas was in the 1970s, the yellow 1960s, and then the blue further ago than that in time. And so we can see that there was kind of a gradual domino effect where they disappeared from far upstream and then gradually declined towards the core of the range. So it contracted inwards over time. And then we did a series of fairly complex models to look at why the dolphins disappeared from those areas. And we considered a whole number of different factors that might have played a role. But the results were really clear. We looked at what factors influenced where they're still found, and why. What factors influenced how fast they disappeared from the areas from which they've already gone, and what factors influenced the time that they disappeared. And in all three cases, the results showed that it was low dry season discharge because of removal of water from the river for irrigation. And in some places, like in this image, which is quite extreme, river flow is really seriously depleted. There's very little water left in the river. So the more water that comes out, the more likely the dolphins are to disappear. It's fairly logical. So that conclusion arms us with the facts that we need to go forward to develop conservation plans. And after my 10 years of involvement or so in Pakistan, there's now a team that are in place in Pakistan of local people who are running the conservation program and taking it forward. I now live in Tanzania and advise from outside. So that's I feel like that is a major accomplishment of the work that I've been involved with, that there is now a homegrown team that are running the program. And they're focused on two different things. These images are from a spate of mortalities that there were after a change in fisheries practice a few years ago. The laws governing the fishery within the protected area changed, and there were large numbers of dead dolphins in one year. things seem to have resolved themselves now, but so my colleagues are working with local fishermen, trying to improve fish practices to reduce the mortality. And then they're working also at much higher levels to develop more sustainable ways of managing the river. And Pakistan, the Indus River in Pakistan is enormously important and political. It's incredibly important for the economy. Water is, everybody is aware of the fact that water is limited. And the primary source of water for the country is the river. And so conserving the Indus dolphin is linked in with much bigger issues of water supply, water management for an entire country. But there is there are many different projects underway to try and improve water management, to try and improve ecology of the river, to ensure that certain amounts of water remain in the river to sustain fisheries and sustain ecology. So we're working within a sort of bigger framework. And just to kind of step out to something broader, there are river dolphins that that exist in at least five other rivers in Asia. And the species vary. There's Finnish paupers in the Yangtze River. There's dolphins in the Mekong, in the Irrawaddy, in a river in Borneo, and in several different brackish water lakes, one in India. So the animals change, but the story everywhere is exactly the same. They are all endangered or critically endangered. These are amongst one of the most endangered groups of mammals on Earth. And the reasons are clear. Rivers are under enormous threat. They're so intensively used by people, especially in Asia. They occur through some of the most densely populated parts of the world. They're used for fishing, they're used for transport, they're dredged, they're numerous people rely upon them. So, and freshwater biodiversity is declining more rapidly than biodiversity anywhere else. But, so the Yangtze River dolphin was the first mammal to go extinct in the last 50 years. So this is a real warning for the other dolphins. But the Indus dolphin, in comparison, we have this warning, and so we can see what can happen. And the Yangtze dolphin disappeared very rapidly. It declined so fast that nobody, in fact, had the time to really look at the causes of why it was disappearing. We're in a much better position now to conserve the Indus dolphin and the Ganges dolphin because we have a little more time and we understand now what the major issues are. So, just to finish with this hopeful image, I think that although these animals are under serious threat, there is still time, and this area of high concentration in Pakistan is in fact cause for hope, and I think that the future of the Indus dolphin is probably looking more healthy than it is for many of the other freshwater cetaceans. And we're in a good position now to move forward.
Hi there, I'm Elizabeth Stevenson and I manage the Marine Conservation Action Fund here, which is honored to have supported Jill and Rohan's work. And it's a real treat for me to have them here tonight because I've known them for a number of years through MCAF, but to have them come here to meet them in person and see them give such wonderful presentations and be able to share it with you meant for a great evening for me. So I'm sure you all enjoyed it as well, and now is our opportunity to ask some questions. Before we do that, I wanted to thank the WGBH Forum Network for filming tonight's lecture and making it available afterwards for you to watch with your family on our Aquarium's YouTube channel. So at this point, I would call Jill and Rohan back up here to the podium so that you can ask your questions. So please,
thank you. Okay. Top right there.
Hi,
So the question was, what are some of the policy changes that have been enacted to impact the river dolphins?
Not having lots of success.
Yes, problem. No, I know.
Okay. So there is, let me go back. Dolphins used to be hunted extensively in Pakistan, and then in the 1970s, they became a protected species. So hunting, and then several people were prosecuted, and hunting really stopped. No longer occurs. So that legislation, I guess, was relatively effective. And at the same time, the high density area was created as a dolphin reserve. There's no restriction on fishing in the reserve. In fact, there's not really, it's a dolphin reserve, basically, not much happens. But now, just earlier this year, the next section upstream, which has the second largest dolphin population, was also declared a reserve, which is in a different province. So that's kind of a new event, which I'm hopeful will actually be effective. But when it comes to river management, that kind of legislation, I don't know if there's actually a change in policy. I mean, really, the issue is so large because it's hydropower is also a source of major source of power for the country, and there's power cuts all the time. So water gets just talked about in the papers constantly. Even like people in the bazaar know what the discharge of the river is. Like it's published every day, and the people downstream are really paranoid about the people upstream taking the water. So and also all the rivers pass through India before they come into Pakistan. There's some tension in that regard too. So politically, it's huge. But there's definitely, I mean, the World Bank is giving a lot of money for trying to improve the irrigation system and improve water management. So there's fairly high level engagement to address water management generally, and that should benefit dolphins too. And talking only about dolphins, really, when the issues are so big, I think you have to take a higher level approach and look at a much bigger picture to really be effective.
Nicobar Islands, is the modern world intruding upon these community practices? Do you find that as people from the rest of the country migrate over there, is it causing a problem?
So the question was, just so you can all hear, is the modern world intruding on the Nicobar Islands?
If I've painted a picture of a community that is completely isolated from the modern world, I've probably done it a disservice. It is a very, very dynamic place. They are relatively isolated. They are isolated because of distance. They are also isolated because of politics, just because of geopolitics of the area. But these are communities that have access to the modern world. They have access to all the amenities. And particularly after the tsunami, we've been able to see that there has been change. There has been much, much more intrusion of the modern world. But these are communities that are constantly adapting. They're not really, they have been converted to Christianity. But as you see, they incorporate Christianity into their shaman beliefs. And so it's a constantly dynamic process. And after the tsunami, we've been studying exactly how some of these processes have been changing. And there's a significant amount of change. But there are some communities that appear to be very, very resilient. They're able to incorporate aspects of the mainland culture and incorporate that into their own dynamic as well. And the communities that do that best are the ones that seem to be most resilient to change.
Yes, go ahead, Randy. Putting your two talks together, I'm sort of watching for Jill. I'm sort of curious whether there are sort of older cultural needs that might be sort of reinvigorated in order to promote water conservation along the river system.
Okay, so melding the two talks, are there older cultural means that can help preserve the Indus River dolphin?
I wish I could say yes. I'm racking my brains. not that I can think of. I mean, the system of dams and canals, and I mean, it is immense. And certainly from a conservation perspective, it makes no sense to actually talk about removing any of those structures. They're there to stay. And if the dolphin is going to survive, it has to survive within that framework. But they're really, I mean, for such a water-stressed place, people treat water with very little care. Like, you just see water running down the street. There isn't much of a, there doesn't seem to be a consciousness that it needs to be managed very carefully, like on an individual level. And so the irrigation system itself is very very old now, and it's very inefficient compared to many other countries. So there's a possibility to upgrade it and line the canals, for example. And there's definitely investment to do that. So not sure that was very uplifting.
The question was about the vaquita off the coast of Mexico, which is a highly endangered marine mammal as well.
Thank you. Yeah, I do work on many other issues other than just river dolphins in Pakistan. So I also work on many different marine dolphins, especially in Africa. And so I'm definitely aware of the vaquita issue. I haven't worked on it personally. So the vaquita, I think the population abundance estimate now is about 100 or something. So and it's a very tiny and very beautiful porpoise that lives in the Gulf of California. And is declining because of bycatch in fisheries. So, but there has been, I think, compared to the Yangtze River dolphins, I was involved with that effort. And so we went to China and we had multiple meetings with the Chinese government to try and implement sort of the final effort to save the Yangtze River dolphin. We had all these plans in place to try and catch the remaining few and keep them somewhere in an oxbow lake where they were going to, until the river conditions improved. It was really sort of the last effort to find the last few. And then the survey happened and we didn't find any at all. They were already gone. So the situation, that was a real shock. I'm an optimist. I expected that we would find a few, and we found none. So at least for the vaquita, it's a very, for me at least, it seems a lot more optimistic. I mean, there's a lot of engagement, certainly from the U.S. government, the National Marine Fisheries Service. There's a lot of really, really smart people who are working on trying to save this animal. And there's definitely, I mean, it's, I don't know if they're going to be successful, but if I compare the situation in China and also in Pakistan with the situation for the vaquita, at least there's a lot more engagement. So if anyone can do it, surely this is a much better situation, at least.
One more question.
Okay,
Joy. I was going to ask about if any of the island areas have been working much on ecotourism for divers, speaking as member of the New England Aquarium
right.
Dive Club.
Yes, Joy is here from the dive club, heads up the dive club here at the aquarium. So yes, so has there been ecotourism efforts going on where you're working?
The Lakshadweep has a small ecotourism effort. In the Nicobars, it's very, very restricted, so it's very difficult to get to these islands. It's difficult for me to get to the islands. So there's no ecotourism in the Nicobars at all. In the Lakshadweep, I think that ecotourism is a double-edged sword. Tourism of any sort is a double-edged sword, because an average tourist essentially uses much, much more water than a local community. And so it has benefits in that it brings economy. It boosts the economy significantly. But then I think the costs of it are to some of the most precious resources, which is fresh water. And given that what we know about climate change and how sea levels are rising, the freshwater resources that they depend on the islands all come from from the freshwater lenses on these islands. And towards the end of the dry season, those freshwater supplies are getting really, really heavily used. And I think that conserving those freshwater supplies are probably going to be very critical. And I'm not completely certain whether ecotourism may be the perfect alternative to, for instance, developing the fishery, as I was talking about.
All right, thank you very much again for coming, and please join us in the lobby. We're having cookies and lemonade there. So thank you again, Jill and Rohan.